I think every one of us know Dr. Ramakrishnan. He's a senior consultant in critical care and sleep medicine, director of critical care services at Apollo Hospitals. He's a founding and managing director of TACT. Now he'll take over.
Good afternoon. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I would like to thank the organizers for inviting. I think we are moving from a symptom that patients commonly present with, which Dr. Dhanashekar elegantly addressed, which is cough, to a disorder where most of the times the patients will not present with the symptoms. Most of them are unaware that they are snoring or don't think that snoring is a real medical problem. So we'll move on to sleep disordered breathing. And just to give an idea, I mean, at Nitra, we only deal with sleep problems. So I just wanted to give you an idea that this is our own patient profile, where we find that a good, you know, almost 50%, 47% of our patients were patients with sleep apnea. But a significant majority is also people presenting with other sleep problems, primarily insomnia, which comes in various forms, those who are unable to sleep, those who are sleeping at odd hours, and we also deal with patients with circadian rhythm disturbances, particularly thanks to the BPO industry, where people can't sleep in the daytime, and restless leg syndrome, parasomnias like sleepwalking, sleep talking, sleep eating, nocturnal seizures, any of those. So we deal with all sleep problems, but I just wanted to project that a significant number of our patients are sleep disordered breathing, which is primarily obstructive sleep apnea. What I thought I'll do in the next 30 to 40 minutes is deal with some cases, and if I'm running out of time, I can stop any time, because they're all case studies. Start with a simple one, which was a 45-year-old gentleman who had a history of hypertension and diabetes, also had coronary artery disease. His blood pressure and diabetes had been difficult to control, and that was one of the reasons that he was referred to us. And he had undergone angioplasty and stent placement for coronary artery disease. Specifically, when we asked him, he said that overall, you know, like although he sleeps about 7 to 8 hours in a night, he wakes up not feeling fresh. That's the usual symptoms that a lot of them would say, non-refreshing sleep. And he feels very fatigued and tired during the daytime. Okay. He did not use the word that I feel sleepy, which is what we expect from patients with obstructive sleep apnea. But he kept saying that he was fatigued and tired during the daytime, and he felt that he was not able to work as well as he would like to. But when you specifically asked him, you know, are you sleepy during the daytime? Do you sleep when you drive? Any of those? He said that he had to have an afternoon nap for more than an hour every day because he's unable to work during that time, which was becoming a problem at work as well. So I brought that up only because don't expect patients to present classically with I feel sleepy all the time, I'm sleeping while driving. We may have to extract the history, and some of that I'll mention to you, that a lot of patients will present with these kind of wake symptoms. And when we asked his wife, she clearly stated that she snores to the extent that they were sleeping in different rooms. So this is something that often comes up when we take a history in sleep apnea patients. Now, when you deal with a patient like this, saying that he's feeling tired, there are various things that run through your mind. Number one, are you dealing with a patient whose symptoms are primarily because his diabetes is not controlled? I mean, significant hyperglycemia, all of those could be causing symptoms, or it could even be over control and he's becoming recurrently hypoglycemic. So think about those. Does he have other coexisting problems? And, you know, a lot of the times with patients with hypertension, diabetes, who are obese, you would find that hypothyroidism kind of coexists, and that could cause some of these symptoms which you need to evaluate. Vitamin D deficiency is gaining a lot of popularity. We really don't know what we are dealing with. Several of us measure vitamin D levels. Is it something we should be replacing? Is it really causing symptoms? We don't know, but it's something to think about. Other neurological problems, you know, is it, you know, chronic cerebrovascular disease? Is something else causing his, you know, fatigue or other symptoms? You need to think about. And intentionally, I put it in the end, but I would probably think of this first, you know, is it coexisting obstructive sleep apnea? And I'll tell you why. What kind of tests should we order? And I'm, for the rest of our discussion, I'm going to focus only on the sleep apnea part and not, you know, the other disorders that could coexist. Based on clinical suspicion, the reason why we decide on what test to order, should I order a sleep study, should I order a portable sleep study, should I order one in lab, those kind of decisions are a lot of the times determined by the pre-test possibility. Here is a patient where you might think that the chances of this patient having obstructive sleep apnea are very high, and therefore you might do a test as quickly as possible, whether it is a portable sleep study, to convince him and yourself that he has a problem to deal with and address it. And we'll talk about sleep studies and all that as we go. Blood tests, sometimes, a lot of these patients are obese and have coexisting obesity hypoventilation syndrome. A lot of patients may have COPD overlap syndrome. So it may be worthwhile getting an arterial blood gas if you suspect that any of these are coexisting. But again, as I said, I'll stick to the sleep apnea part. And the real question is, should we order portable sleep study? Should we order a full polysomnogram? And I know a significant number of you here are pulmonologists who may be interested in primarily sleep apnea and probably not the other sleep disorders. And it's much easier to get a portable sleep study done and interpret it. So if you have a high clinical suspicion, certainly you can go for a portable sleep study, and we'll address the advantages and disadvantages of both. Now, what are the classic symptoms of patients who are prone to present with obstructive sleep apnea? You can broadly classify it as nighttime symptoms, daytime symptoms. The main thing is loud, persistent snoring. Lot of the times, the spouse who observes or anybody else who observes, I'm sure you can diagnose it in train, planes, and wherever you travel, people having sleep apnea, where you'll find that they may have a crescendo of snoring, then suddenly they stop breathing, and then, the whole cycle starts again. So those who observe may say that they have witnessed process of breathing, and in fact, spouses will very clearly tell you, I've got used to the sound. I can sleep when the person snores. However, if I don't hear the snoring, I know that he has stopped breathing or she has stopped breathing, and therefore they just turn them to one side, and the lateral position kind of opens the airway again and they start breathing. Sometimes the patients themselves may say that they wake up with a choking sensation or gasping for air, and that's typically happening during these apneic episodes. Invariably, these patients may have restless sleep. I have patients, spouses, who tell me that they've fallen off the bed, they jerk, they move out, they turn around a lot, toss around a lot in bed, very restless sleep that they experience. A lot of the times they may have frequent visits to the bathroom, nocturia as a common symptoms, particularly, since they have coexisting diabetes, you may wonder whether it is due to diabetes. But in obstructive sleep apnea, they could have increased atrial natriuretic peptide secretion, which can lead to nocturia and polyuria as well. So these are the common nocturnal symptoms. And because of this, mouth breathing, a lot of them may also complain of dryness of the throat when they wake up at night. When they wake up, despite sleeping 7 to 8 hours, a lot of them will feel not refreshed. That's the classic symptom that they would have. And some of them will say that they wake up with a headache and feel very tired or lazy or, whatever they call it. And they say that they have daytime sleepiness. And this can vary in extent. Some of them would say that if I'm doing anything monotonous or if I do anything that I cannot concentrate or don't feel like concentrating, like a lecture or when the lights are turned off, or when you're sitting in front of a computer, they may doze off. But it can get to the extent where they start sleeping even when they have to concentrate. And the classic example is people who are sleepy while driving. I've had some of my own colleagues, doctors, who have come to me saying that they had to stop in a signal and then pull over because they felt sleepy and have been diagnosed with sleep apnea. So think about it. Overall, feeling very irritable, not able to concentrate, chronic, over a period of time, developing memory loss. All these are related to the hypoxia, which could probably be triggering some of these responses. And as I said, falling asleep while driving. I specifically wanted to bring this up because there have been studies done where people have noticed that most of the time people will report lack of energy, feeling fatigued or tired, rather than saying that they are sleepy. So don't expect them to use the word sleepy. Try to get it out of them by asking kind of leading questions. So once you have decided that this patient has sleep apnea, what are you going to order? I mean, there are different types of sleep studies available, not to mean to go to all the details, but I just wanted you to be aware of the various levels of study that are available. The level one is the classic one that you do in the sleep lab all the EEG channels, EMG channels, respiratory channels, pulse oximetry, ECG, leg EMG, chin EMG, all those are included, and it's an attended study where the technician is present and can intervene. You know, like if there has been significant desaturation, or if they want to do a split night sleep study, they can decide to go on and use the CPAP. So all this is possible. So this is the full comprehensive sleep study that we do, which is called the level 1 study. There's a level 2 study, which is one step less, which is comprehensive but portable. You can even do it in the patient's home. Little less number of channels, it's unattended. That's a big difference. And there is a move in the West where they also want to make this remotely attended, where it can be, you know, connected at home, but, you know, through wireless or other monitoring, we can do it at, they can be monitored in a sleep lab. Level 3 is something a lot of pulmonologists in India use, which is a modified, you know, portable study where you pretty much have 3 to 4 channels, and it's an unattended study, and some people call it cardio-respiratory study, where basically you're looking at what is the airflow, is the patient snoring, what is the chest and abdominal effort, and this help, and the pulse oximetry, which indirectly gives you also the heart rate. So that gives you an analysis on, does this patient have sleep apnea. And level 4 is just, a lot of the times it's just pulse oximetry using nasal airflow at best, and, you know, kind of a surrogate. Some people say it is kind of a screening, but it is not really going to help you unless you are having a very, very high level of suspicion for sleep apnea. Okay, who really decides what are the kind of studies that you're going to order? And this is somewhat from the West, but I do want to focus that the decision is based on, one, are there sleep labs available? Can you do it locally near your place? A lot of the times you may be in a place where only portable studies are available, in which case you may have to opt for that and then decide on a higher level of study only for specific patients if required. Patients may direct what they want. There are patients who come and say, I cannot come to a sleep lab, I cannot sleep in a different environment, I can only sleep at home. As long as you explain to them what are the limitations that you have with the portable sleep study, it may be okay. And of course, it has to be clinician driven. Some of these haven't happened in our country as yet. You know, insurers don't pay for any outpatient study, it's not yet done. Suppliers or the industry is playing a key role in our country, fortunately or unfortunately, where a lot of these studies are done by industry and are given unreported to the doctors, and therefore can be really tricky. You know, I had a study that was given to me yesterday, which was reported as normal, which turned out, A, it was not appropriately done, but more importantly, there were a lot of subtle elements in that, which clearly showed that the patient had desaturated to 60s and 70s, and it was missed and reported as normal. We do not have regulatory bodies that are governing it yet. Professional societies like our own Indian Sleep Disorders Association are working towards it, but frankly, you know, like, it's still kind of a developing specialty where a lot of these are not really clear. So as I mentioned, if you decide on a portable sleep study, the primary thing should be if you have a high clinical index of suspicion, if your pretest probability is really high, and as long as you get the data and the raw data is reviewed by some trained specialist, if you have undergone some sleep study training, and more importantly, you need to have a post-test follow-up. It's not just giving the report to the patient and then taking a decision. Some kind of quality programs audit need to be in place, and more importantly, if it is unclear to you and if it doesn't match the clinical presentation of the patient, please think of referring to a higher level of center where it can be taken care of. This is our own study. We looked at 1,000 consecutive patients in Nitra, and we found that a significant number of patients, almost about 65% of the patients, presented to us by themselves. They were all self-referred, looking at internet and, you know, reading in the media or any of those. And only about 40% were referred by other doctors. So we presented this in American College of Chest Physicians, where we think that sleep medicine in India, you know, patients are probably more aware than referral physicians, and that's something that needs to change. But fortunately, it was slightly better for sleep apnea than for insomnia. Insomnia, a lot of the times, they present themselves. So this, going back to our patient who, you know, clinically we were suspecting that he had a high index of suspicion for sleep apnea, he underwent a portable sleep study. The study was given to you unreported, so you are going to look at what are the things that you are going to look at. One is the apnea-hypopnea index, and we'll talk about this in the next couple of slides. You need to look at what we call the ODI or the oxygen desaturation index, not just the number of times that their breathing is affected, but also how significantly is their oxygen saturation getting affected. Pattern of desaturation, if you remember, every about 90 minutes or so, we go through a REM cycle. And so, roughly if you sleep at 10, around 12 to 4, you may have REM cycle, and you would find that the REM cycles are more and more prolonged as we get to the early morning. And the chances of somebody having apneas and desaturation is a lot more during REM sleep because there is lack of muscle tone during the REM sleep. And if you find that the pattern of desaturation is predominantly during REM, that's also something equally important where you can miss if you just average it out. Let's imagine that the patient has apnea index of almost 60 or 70 during REM and 5 or 10 during non-REM. When you average it, it may look like 15 or 20 and you may think it is only mild sleep apnea, when in fact, it is a severe REM-related sleep apnea. So look at the pattern of desaturation and understand the limitations of the portable study. If you put the equipment on and you're sending this patient unattended and the patient does not sleep all night, it's going to look like a normal study. It will look like the patient has no sleep apnea. So if the patient doesn't sleep, it may be a problem, and you cannot clearly diagnose REM-related sleep apnea unless you are looking for it and have the eye for it. Okay. Just quickly to define, when you are looking at obstructive apneas, you are going to find that there is absolutely no airflow, whereas there is a continued thoracic and abdominal effort that you will see in these patients. So that's the classic apnea, and to define something as apnea, it should last at least 10 seconds or longer in an adult, whereas in children, it's about 6 seconds or longer, we would define it as a apnea or an event. This is the hypopnea where you are finding, so you will find that there is still some airflow, but it's reduced and there is continued effort. So previously we used to distinguish between the apnea and hypopnea significantly, but now we understand that both have the same kind of physiological effects on the body, and therefore we club them together and we call it apnea-hypopnea index. So the number of times you have apnea and hypopnea per hour is what we call apnea-hypopnea index. So you will see that the saturation also starts dropping. This is a mixed apnea. This is a mixed apnea where you find initially that there is a central apnea where, there is no thoracic or abdominal effort, there is no airflow, but later on you are seeing some efforts from the chest and abdomen. So this is a mixed apnea. The one thing you should remember is with any of these apneas, this desaturation will happen predominantly after the event. So when you are looking during the event, you may think that the saturation looks normal, but subsequent to the event, the desaturation may happen. So this is a central apnea where you don't see any airflow, don't see any thoracic effort, or don't see any abdominal effort. Okay. So how do we classify obstructive sleep apnea? As I said, you need to look at the number of events, the number of apneas and hypopneas per hour, which is what we call apnea-hypopnea index. There's another index that we often use called RDI or respiratory disturbance index. And that can be analyzed only when you're doing a full polysomnogram, because it takes into account respiratory events where there may not be significant desaturation, but it's just associated with an arousal of an EEG arousal. So you cannot measure RDI when you're doing portable four-channel studies. It can only be done with studies including the EEG. So the severity we classify as based on the apnea-hypopnea index. If it is less than 5, we consider it as normal. If it's 5 to 15, we call it as mild obstructive sleep apnea. 16 to 30 is moderate, and if it's more than 30, it is severe. Okay, so this is one thing that definitely we need to look at when we are looking at the study. Now, what we need to remember is sleep apnea is a multi-system disease. It is not just related to pulmonary. It has significant effects on the rest of the body, and there are a lot of evidences clearly to suggest that sleep apnea by itself can make hypertension worse, can make diabetes worse. There are clear documentation saying that if anybody has poor control of hypertension, or if you think that they have secondary hypertension, one of the things you need to rule out is obstructive sleep apnea. And this is recommended by the Joint Institute of Health for you know, hypertension societies. Diabetes, same story. Clearly shown that if you have obstructive sleep apnea and it is not controlled, then you can develop diabetes, or if you already have diabetes, your control can be poor. So if you see that somebody's glycosylated hemoglobin is persistently elevated, ask them if they are snoring or if they have any other symptoms of sleep apnea and look for sleep apnea. And particularly in our country, we find that, and we have published it in Indian Journal of Sleep Medicine, we found that a lot of our diabetics who have sleep apnea are actually non-obese. So don't think that it has to be associated with obesity. You would find that if you don't treat, in addition to hypertension and diabetes, sleep apnea can be an independent risk factor for cardiovascular disease and stroke. And this is just to show you that worsening the severity, you would find that the glycosylated levels can be worse when you're managing patients with diabetes. Okay, so this patient, you've done the sleep study and it confirms severe obstructive sleep apnea. What are your treatment options? This is something a lot of patients will come and ask you whether we can treat with medications. Unfortunately, obstructive sleep apnea, there is no medical therapy other than treating the other underlying problems. You know, like you need to treat hypothyroidism if it is coexisting. If the patient drinks a lot of alcohol, you need to try and tell them to stop. If they have a coexisting COPD, of course you treat that. If they are smokers, stop that. So all of those are the medical treatment that you can offer as far as supportive treatment. But the only thing that is clearly shown to help, particularly in moderate to severe sleep apnea, is continuous positive airway pressure, CPAP, and different options are available. Surgical treatment does help if it is a mild obstructive sleep apnea or in primary snorers. Some ENT surgeries do help, like the classic UP3 or laser-assisted uvuloplasty. But more importantly, in our country, in India, we find that a lot of our patients may have changes, or I don't even want to use the word abnormalities, but different jaw structure. You might find that they have retrognathia, they may have, you know, like hypoplasia of the mandible. So look for those, and those can be corrected with oral appliances if that's what you're finding. Or if they have significant retrognathia, you may need to even do mandibular advancement surgeries. So how do we convince the patient? As I said, a lot of the times, it takes much longer to convince them on the treatment than to diagnose it. So you need to explain to them that the classic example I quote is, I tell them that in medicine, there are few things you can treat with medications. There are some things for which you need equipment. And the classic example is wearing glasses. If you can't see, I can't give you tablets. You need to wear glasses. So similarly here, if you have sleep apnea, which is severe, the only treatment that's going to work for you is probably the CPAP. And you need to give them for a trial, see how they feel. And unless they are convinced with the treatment, they're not going to buy it, because cost plays a significant role in that. So that's something you need to think about. Auto titration is becoming more and more popular. It's frankly a very Indian thing that everybody uses auto titrating CPAP, and that's primarily because, number one, the cost difference between the manual CPAP and auto CPAP is not that significant in our country. And a lot of the patients who come to us think that if they get an auto titrating CPAP, they don't need to follow up with a doctor on a regular basis, and that it saves on the cost of multiple repeated visits to the doctor. So it seems to be popular, but scientifically there is no major advantage of using auto CPAP over manual CPAP. In fact, there are studies from Australia that say that if you look at 100 patients with obstructive sleep apnea and the kind of pressure that they need with CPAP, almost about 85 to 90% of them will require between 8 to 12 centimeters. And therefore, they say that if you think it is severe, use 12 centimeters. If you think it's mild, give them 8 centimeters and use it. So, you know, titration, the role of it, do you really need to do auto titrating CPAP? All those are something that can be variable from individual setup. Am I okay for time? 5 more minutes, okay. So another patient, 30-year-old male, as you can see, is significantly obese, 110 kilos, diagnosed with severe CPAP, sleep apnea. Had a nasal CPAP titration, and he was using 12 centimeters pressure as optimal. His daytime symptoms improved, okay, and he was on a diet and he lost weight, and then he stopped CPAP and said, I don't have any symptoms, why should I use it? This is another common situation you would find in patients who are obese. The moment they lose some weight, they will feel better. Okay, so this is just more for a science purpose. You are not going to be doing multiple sleep studies on this patient. But look at this here. When he was 112 kilos, he was requiring 12 centimeters. And then, you know, like his apnea index was around 60 per hour, more when it was supine, all of those, and he was frequently getting aroused. When he lost about 5 kilos, okay, you see that the apnea-hypopnea index dropped to 5. Okay. And then when he lost another 5 kilos, it was somewhere in that mild range. Of course, it was more when he was supine. But why I'm trying to say this is, when patients lose about 5% of their body weight, if it is predominantly due to the obesity, you would find that their symptoms are improving and it's very difficult to convince them to continue using the CPAP. Because, you know, like, it's been shown that unless the patient is symptomatic, it's unlikely that they would use the CPAP. So I'll move that on. This is one situation where we know that patients undergoing bariatric surgery, when they lose significant body weight, they may not need CPAP, and that's something that we need to explain to them. Another patient, 55-year-old female with excessive daytime sleepiness, 4 years duration, snored heavily, observed by spouse to stop breathing. They've read about sleep apnea and they come and tell you that they want to save cost, so they don't want you to do any sleep study. Can you just give me a CPAP? Okay. This is another thing you will see commonly. I had one patient day before yesterday coming from Nellore and said that I have sleep apnea, you've given me CPAP, this is my friend, he also has the same symptoms, I came to buy a CPAP. Okay, so it's you have to tell them that it's not something that you're just going to buy and start using. It's important for you to help them understand what it is. The reason I brought this up is sometimes in these situations we may do what is called a split night sleep study, and I wanted you to be aware of that. So there are very clear criteria for how you do a split night sleep study. You need to at least have 2 hours of the diagnostic portion. You need to understand what the severity of the disease is, or if the apnea hypopnea index remains more than 40 per hour with significant oxygen desaturation, and you need to get at least a good 3 hours for CPAP titration so that you understand how much is required to eliminate the apneas and hypopneas. Split night study is certainly economical, you know, because the whole thing you are doing in one night, but it reduces the time both for the diagnosis and for the CPAP titration. Keep that in mind, and you need to interpret that with caution when you are looking at sleep studies. Okay. Last case, 52-year-old man with OSA complained that his CPAP wasn't working because he's still feeling sleepy. This is another situation you will deal with. You diagnose sleep apnea, you've given them CPAP, they're coming back saying, yes, I'm using it, but you know, I don't feel much better. So his Epworth sleepiness score, which is what we use for assessing the severity, was remaining still quite high. You know, this is a scale where you're looking at how sleepy they are, and anything more than 10 is significant. So he was diagnosed with sleep apnea 2 months ago. He's on 12 centimeters. Wife states that he's not snoring on positive pressure, and the patient was denying any mask leaks or dry mouth or any of those. Commonest thing you need to think about is, number one is non-compliance. Okay, if you know, patients will say, I'm using CPAP, but you need to look at the compliance report, see how many hours they are using, see how many days they are using. Preferably, they should use at least 4 hours a day, 4 hours a night, which is really going to make them treatment. So the number one thing is inadequate CPAP treatment. Maybe the pressure is low, maybe there are mask leaks, mouth leaks, look for those. Then you need to think about coexisting sleep disorders. Are they getting adequate sleep? Is it insufficient sleep syndrome that's causing it? Do they have coexisting narcolepsy? Do they have restless leg syndrome or other things that are actually making them sleepy? Any kind of depression, mood disorder, other chronic pain syndromes, all of those can make them feel tired and fatigued despite them using CPAP. So you need to make sure that they are accepting and adhering to the CPAP by talking to them, giving them the appropriate support for using the CPAP. But despite all of this, if you feel that they are continuing to have, there is a subgroup which despite compliance and appropriate treatment may feel sleepy, and you may need to use stimulants in that group of patients if you know that they've complied with CPAP for at least 6 weeks in a month. So I'll stop there. Just wanted to kind of reinforce that it's sleep apnea, like hypertension and diabetes, is an independent risk factor for cardiovascular morbidity and stroke. So think about it, because snorers irrespective of whether they have other cardiac risk factors or not, are at increased risk for cardiovascular disease. And a lot of the times you'll see these patients only after they have had a heart attack or so. There's a lot of formal training in sleep medicine that's being increasingly available. ISDA has short-term courses. We also have a one-year sleep diploma. And at Nitra, we have a one-year postdoctoral fellowship accredited by the Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University. So those of you who are interested, I think you should certainly see how you can improve your interest in sleep medicine. And I would also like to close by inviting you all. Every year we do a critical care conference, Apollo Advanced Critical Care Symposium. The date is fixed. It's always on the first weekend of August. And this year's theme is translating guidelines to bedside practice. Those of you who are interested, please contact me and I'm happy to send you details. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that wonderful presentation on sleep. Since we are behind schedule, I don't think I'll allow any time for questions. You can talk with him over lunch. On behalf of Institute Hospital, we'd like to give a small memento to sleep.